is my pleasure to introduce the Honorable Anne Mary Slatter, President and CEO of the New America Foundation and former Director of Policy Planning at the United States Department of State.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Ah, I can tell you're caffeinated. So we're going to have a discussion about women's empowerment, and I have a wonderful panel here to do it. But before I introduce them and start our conversation, I'd like to just offer some of my own reflections on what I think leadership means, and then to what extent that differs by gender, and then I'll open up that conversation since we have three terrific women leaders. And I should start by saying I have been a dean, I've been the director of policy planning, I'm now president and CEO of a think tank and civic enterprise. I did not think I was a leader until my late 30s, and mostly because my husband asked why I was not putting myself forward as the president, as a candidate to be president of the American Society of International Law. Now, mind you, I was a Harvard law professor. I taught international law. I had a few credentials, but it didn't dawn on me that I might be president. And many women will nod their heads at that story. I look back and think, how could I have not thought I was a leader, but I was in my late 30s. And so then the question is, what kind of leader are you? And this applies to all leaders. Two broad categories. Are you a great steward or are you a transformational leader? And if you look at job applications, you either have a great institution or maybe not a great institution, but an institution that really needs a terrific steward, somebody who will preserve what has been built and keep it going, versus a transformational leader where you have something that needs a turnaround or maybe just to be radically renovated, if you think about a building term. So what kind of leader are you? Very important to know. I'm a transformational leader. I would not take a job that needed a good steward because that's not my skill set. So something to think about. And then personal style. I always say that Joseph Nye, who many of you will recognize as somebody who's a longtime professor at Harvard, government official, he was the dean of the Kennedy School. And when I became dean of the Woodrow Wilson School, Joe had been a mentor of mine, I admired him, and I watched the way he leads. Now, Joe is one of these people who's very, what I would call Olympian, right? He has a sort of demeanor, he speaks very softly. When he speaks, everybody listens. He has a kind of distant way of leadership that works very well for him. It does not work for me. You have to think about who you are and craft a leadership style that works for you. So then the third thing I wanted to reflect on was the single most important piece of advice I got when I became dean of the Wilson School from John Sexton, who was at that point dean of NYU Law School and then president of NYU, who is one of the most amazing transformative leaders I've ever seen. He said, the single most important thing you need to know as a leader is what you are not good at, and then assume it's not going to change. Right, so this, for any of you who diet, do not assume that tomorrow you will no longer have a sweet tooth, right? Know here are my strengths, and here is what I'm not that good at, and then compensate for it. If you're a visionary but not great at details, hire somebody who's great at details. If you, on the other hand, are somebody who really thinks systematically but often lacks creative vision, hire somebody who's really creative. But don't assume it's going to change. And then when I think about being a leader and the great leaders that I have watched, there are three characteristics that I think are most important. And I know all of you are studying leadership and ethical leadership in particular. So I think this is particularly important for the McCain Institute. I'd say courage, character, and humility. Courage, without courage, you can't lead. And above all, the courage not to be liked, the courage to say things people don't want to hear, preferably in a way that means they're still listening to you. But if you want everybody to like you, if you want to be popular, if you want to go along, you're not going to be successful. You have to be able to be that voice in the room that kind of screws your courage to the sticking place and says, okay, this is what I think needs to be done, or I think this is what I think is happening. And then character. I mean, this is what you're all learning, but I think there are few things more important. And I'm going to talk about it in the context of work and family, something I've written a little bit about. If I have somebody who's working for me who has a choice, who does not go home if a child or a parent or a spouse needs them, I mean, gets a call and says, you know, your child just fell off the playground and is being taken to the emergency room, or simply going home. If that person says, no, I'll stay here at work, that's not the kind of character I want in the people who work for me. Now, I understand there are situations where you have no choice, you'll lose your job, you have to support your family, of course. But character is not just in the boardroom. It is who you are as a whole person and what are your values. And in my view, standing up and taking care of the people you love, and I don't care if they're your biological family or a constructed family or a friend with cancer, but that's part of character. And it permeates everything you do. And finally, humility, which is, again, know what you're not good at, but also do not assume that being a great leader means getting out front and expecting people to follow. Understand that you have to blend a vision with bringing people with you. So how does any of this break down on gender lines? And I'm going to ask my panel to reflect on any of what I've said from their personal experience. And many of us are uncomfortable being identified as women leaders. Right? I'm a leader. I'm not a woman leader. I'm a leader. On the other hand, I'm acutely aware that there are many fewer of me in the high circles that I often have occasion to be in than there are men. So it is important to focus on how many women are in the room, just as it is important to focus on all kinds of diversity. But this question, do women lead differently? Different women will answer that question differently. What I will say is that I think it is often harder for women to break the mold. Women are conditioned to conform in so many more ways. Young men, I'm the mother of two boys, and I'm the sister of two brothers. I've watched this my entire life. You know, when guys break the mold, they're often rewarded, even when they're bad. Right? You know, oh, boys will be boys. And people will often say, you know, that same rebelliousness will serve him well later on. I certainly wasn't raised that way as a girl. I was raised not quite better to be seen but not heard. But women who put themselves forward, you pay a social price and you often pay a professional price. So I think it is harder for women to be transformative leaders, and they have to adapt all sorts of strategies to not upset people too much and not to be seen as not feminine, even though other people rarely recognize they're actually exercising that kind of bias. On the other hand, humility often comes easily to women, perhaps too much so, but sometimes in a very good way, in the sense that they will seek advice and be more collaborative. And on the issue of character, I was reading Sebastian Younger's book, Tribe, this morning. I strongly recommend it. And he cited a bunch of studies that said men are more likely to exercise physical courage in a group of men and women. If somebody's in trouble and you need to risk your life to save that person, you know, the drowning child, whatever, more likely to be a man. A woman is most likely to do it only when there are no other women present. But women are more likely to exercise moral courage. The courage that stands up and says, this is wrong. Sheltering Jews in the Holocaust is the example he uses. So with that very swift overview of leadership and gender differences, let me introduce my panel. And we are going to talk about those issues, but I'm going to ask them more broadly about how they think about women's empowerment. So to my immediate right, we have Kimberly King. She's an innovator and a social entrepreneur. and a global change agent. I love that way of describing yourself. Note what she does, not what titles she holds. She's worked in public health, in sustainable development, and in the education and empowerment of women. She is an advisor and a board member for lots of organizations, but in particular, she's the representative to the UN Commission on the Status of Women and the UN Committee on Sustainable Development. To her right is Dr. Karambu Ringera. Did I say that right?
Yes, you did. Yeah.
Who is most important here, a 2015 NGL. She is a Kenyan civil society activist and a public policy professional. And she seeks to promote citizen action and good governance influence, and also, critically here, expanded leadership programming for current and future Kenyan leaders. And we were talking earlier, she's based in Meru, Kenya. Important, she's not in the capital. She is out working in a more rural area with people trying to cultivate leaders. And to her right is Siham Mamand, who is also a 2014 NGL. She is the assistant head of foreign relations for the Kurdish regional government. She's based in Erbil. And she works specifically with women, empowering them to break into leadership roles in both the public and private sectors of Kurdistan, and fighting what are often very deep cultural norms on the role of women in Kurdish culture. So with that, I'm going to actually ask you to start going from my far right back to Kimberly. So I'm going to ask Siham to start and reflect on what I said in the context of your own thinking about leadership, and particularly women's leadership.
Thank you very much. I'm glad to be here to be in partner with my speaker from Africa and America, just to discuss this subject together, to see our perspective towards each other also. Leadership to me, I think every woman is dreaming to be a leader and is wishing to have a leader in different position among the society that she is living in. And one of them is me. I started from a rural area in among the tribal society. I started the schooling and then moving to the high school and then moving to the college, but I was facing a huge challenges in my life. But I was continuously committed to continue the education, because I was believing in the education, and I was believing that it is the only one, a way that could take me to the aim that I am struggling for. So after all, after I got the chance to go to abroad to have my MA, to come back to work at the same Department of Foreign Relations, and I started from zero staff with me. I was the first person that get to employed in Department of Foreign Relations, but it was hard for us, but I encouraged to bring a lot of young boys and girls also, and those who are capable, who have the ability of language and have the emotion to work. So nowadays I have 258 staffs that I really wanted to give the same opportunity that I passed through, especially for our women, to play a better role, to gain skill, to have a confidence in themselves, so that to have a better vision for their future. So this is my view, and I believe in my view to encourage other women in the different sector of my government, in different ministries, departments, and also the boards, to bring them together to share the other stories with us, so that to see ourselves, where can we find the best solution to promote the position of the woman in the all sectors of social and economical and political position in our government.
Thank you. So, Karambu, do you agree that every woman actually wants to be a leader if she only could?
What I know is that every woman is a leader. Yes. As to whether they believe that or not is actually the space that I've been working with in Kenya. I grew up in a society that taught me that leaders are others out there. I live in a society that taught me that, for example, God is out there somewhere. And it took me a long time to recognize that unless I know how to lead myself, I cannot lead someone else. So our work has been about not only empowering women to become leaders, it has also become how do women take that empowerment and turn it into what we are calling empoweredness. Because empowerment is what someone does for you. Empoweredness is what you choose to do with that gift that you've been given in form of a skill, in form of education, in form of whatever it is. And so the dance has been for people who never saw themselves or don't believe that they're women, society and everybody has told them that they are not leaders. How do we change that mindset so that they see the leader in them, but fundamentally recognize what are the values and principles that underline who I am? You talked about people recognizing or knowing who they are. And until I knew who I was and identified the values that undergirded who I say I am, irrespective of what my parents said I am, or what my husband said I was, or everybody else, it's who fundamentally am I? What are the values that undergird who I say I am? And then that becomes the foundation upon which I lead myself and partner with others so that together we are leaders as women.
Thank you. You know, that's very interesting. It highlights something that I think is also very much a difference between more traditional society, and I don't just mean Kenyan society, I mean traditional society here too, where boys or young men are socialized to be individuals and women are socialized to be in relationship to others. So I remember my mother saying to me that when she was growing up, she never thought about what she wanted. She was a daughter, a sister, and she was going to become a wife and a mother, so that her identity was constructed in relationship always to other people, as opposed to who are you and what do you want as an agent of your own destiny. Now, obviously, all of us are both, but where you put the emphasis does really matter in terms of do you think of yourself as somebody who can chart your own course and lead others. So Kimberly, from the UN perspective, you look at all countries and in your own work, how do you respond?
Well, first of all, I'm a liaison to the UN. And the distinction I want to point out about that is that I have the freedom to have my own opinion.
Yes.
And that I get to sometimes uphold the banner and perception and the trust of the UN, but also the sovereignty that I think you need in order to really be present. And so I like that distinction. And one of the things that strikes me in my privilege as one who gets to travel around the world is that this is definitely not a phenomena, the rising of women into the truth of who they are, the leadership that is our birthright. This is not happening in one corner of the world or another. This rising has initiated itself. It's like we all got the memo, but I don't know who sent it. Well, maybe I do, but that's a different conversation. What I do know is that it's a consciousness whose time has come and will not go back, that it is absolutely about humanity rising in the face of women, and it is about us rising together. I am a happily married woman, have many men business partners and friends. This is not the rise of matriarchy. This is the rise of partnership and the rise of dignity. And I think it couldn't come at a more important time in our human evolution. So that's what I see around the world, is that it comes in every face, every color, every religion, and it's here to stay, and it's good.
Thank you. I love that phrase. I just wrote it down. The rising of women into the truth of who they are. It's a lovely way to put it. So let's turn more to the obstacles. And Siham, I'll come back to you. I agree with you that I think there's a general consciousness. And just for those of you who might be sports fans, particularly among the Americans in the room, if you watch the Super Bowl, you might have noticed a number of ads that are kind of surprising for a sport that is regarded as, you know, that there are more men, presumably, in the Super Bowl audience than women. At least that's been traditionally presumed. And there was, you know, there was one in particular by Audi that sort of had a man talking about his daughter and all the obstacles she faced, but, you know, he was going to tell her she was a winner. But there are obstacles, right? We wouldn't be sitting here and talking about women's empowerment if it were, you know, we just rise and there's nothing to stop us. So what are the biggest obstacles you face in your work?
Absolutely. We have a lot of obstacles. Looking at the Middle East, we will see that the advancement of the woman in general in the Middle East is always recognized as a major challenge facing us. Because a woman in the Middle East is not enjoying the same right that man is enjoying. So the same as to my region, Kurdistan region, when we came to the Kurdistan region, we, a Kurdish woman, also are facing some, until now, some social norms. And there are a lot of obstacles that stand in front of us. For example, we should not see one size fits for all. Maybe the solution that apply for the Latin America could not apply for my Kurdistan region, and the same to your country also. So here it is important to focus on, because the European country, for example, you have the state and religion are separate body, but when we come to the Middle East, we will see that, including my region, the Islamic Sharia is linked with everything. So there are three things in our society that play a good role, which is Islamic Sharia and fatwa and mosque. These are, whenever we as a woman taking a step forward to have a plan, we face challenges. We have to think about what is the best solution, to take it to consideration. How can we apply our plan according to this Islamic Sharia? So, for example, in our society, in our government, we need, there are some institutions that stands as a challenger for us. We already have made some advance as a government, but still there are challenges, because looking at the judiciary system, it needs to be rebuilt and to strengthening this judiciary system, at least to review some old law that give the right and guarantee for the woman as men have it, and to inform some new laws also, so that to give the woman to be able to make progress and achievement. For example, looking at the case of female genital mutilation, the council, the Women Higher Council, started to campaign to decrease this phenomenon in my country, and to ban the phenomenon at the race route, but they tried to go through the media campaign, but for a long time we couldn't see any result. But when they thought that it's the best way to go to the mullah, the religion man, to give the preach in the mosque to discuss this subject, and we saw a huge positive result come for that. The same thing for honor killing. It's very difficult to ban the honor killing, which was spreaded among my country the last 8 years, but the government has taken steps to ban this phenomenon also. They are just a norm and tradition and phenomenons. It has nothing with the religion. But the society see all these until now in the glance of the religion and the Sharia. So it is difficult to stand against those challenges that we are. The same thing with the early marriage. The same thing with the polygamy. Polygamy, man has the right to have for women, for wife. We cannot ban this. It is something linked with the religion, but at least the government has given the limited space, and we established some order. But still, people are taking women from our side to the other part of the Iraq. They get married and then came back to us because the law is only established in our region. It is overlooked by the rest of the Iraq. So,
the law of monogamy.
The law of polygamy. The government made a limited and with some restrictions. Put some hard restrictions for men not to marry for women. Right. So
they go elsewhere and marry.
Yeah, they go elsewhere to marry and then came back. So it's hard. We have challenges like this, and we have many other challenges, but I will give the role for my brother.
That's very helpful, and I'm going to come back and ask, you identified, obviously, religion, culture. One of the questions then, which I'll ask you as the next set of questions, is who are your allies? I mean, you talked about the the Western culture and media versus mullahs. I think many people whom I know who are feminists would not think that mullahs might help. I mean, they're presumptions about that are very different.
Yeah, that was our idea also at the beginning. As Council of Women Affairs, they started to go through other channel, yep, through education, through media. But when they saw that there is no result, they thought about using the religious way. And it was very good result. It came out with good result and positive. And I can say that from 65%, it comes to 15-20%. That the phenomenon has been reduced this way.
So, Karambu, the obstacles you face, the biggest ones, there are many.
So I actually begin by saying that in my work, I got to a point where I started seeing so-called obstacles as opportunities. So when I carried the mindset, and my context is really working with women living with HIV and AIDS and children who've lost their parents to HIV and AIDS. So there are people who thought, for the women, that they're going to die anytime. For the young people, is that their life is now gone because they don't have parents. However, I said, let's look at HIV and AIDS as an opportunity that you've been given, I said, to reclaim our lives. And reclaim is actually values that we've given the letters, taking responsibility and being accountable, having courage, and so on and so forth. So when you take something that is called a problem and turn it into an opportunity, you bring a different kind of mindset to that situation. So I said, for the women, the opportunity we have here is you carry this mindset and you die tomorrow and your children go to the streets. Or we figure how we are going to dance with this situation so that the women live longer so that the children don't have to go to the streets. And so it totally changed the mindset of the women in terms of, and even myself, looking at these things that we call problems. And then looking at who are the allies, who are the people that you're going to work with to help change this scenario. But the worst enemy for us was the women themselves and the mindsets that they carry about the context and those things that stop us, like religion, like systems, institutions, and things like that. How do you need to understand these systems so that you know how they impede you, including your mind, so that then you can work to overcome those things. So our approach became educational, to understand ourselves, but also to understand the context within which we work, so that we can then, I call it dancing with life, with all these elements, so that then we can move them to a different level.
I love the image of dancing with life and trying to turn obstacles into opportunities. It's very interesting what you say, in that the beginning of the second wave of feminism in the United States in the early 1960s through the 1960s started with the phrase, the personal is political. And what they meant was very similar to what you just said, that you had a lot of women who were depressed. And those of you who remember, there were many women relying on various kinds of pills that had been prescribed, but there was a relatively high rate of depression. Now, this is white suburban women. This is not all women across the United States. But these were, if you look at Betty Friedan and the feminist mystique, but what those feminists taught them, this is not you. This is not personal. You are in this role that has been assigned to you by a particular economic system and set of cultural norms. It's not your fault, and together we can do something. But it's, again, the starting and trying to help someone see their own situation in a way that gives them greater agency. So, Kimberly, obstacles that you see, or that you've seen those that mentioned, or others?
Well, I think Karambu hits on the first hurdle, and that is how you see yourself and how you believe, what it is you believe. We are facing how others perceive us. We are facing tradition and lots of things. But the line in the sand is an inside job for every person. And I think that's why so many of our programs start first with the whole woman. Like, when she discovers anew who she really is, or decides to believe that voice, her journey has officially begun. And she has now stepped into leadership and what that really means. Long before you have a title, you may never have a title, but if you are now walking your path, and if you are bringing others with you, you are a leader, period. And I think that women have the soul of courage when it comes to not only bettering themselves, but taking the others with them. It is proven that they do that in their home, in their community, in their business, in their parliament. That's why it makes a difference across sectors. That make a seat at the table for her. She will make the table better.
That's wonderful. So it is, we have 13 minutes, and I want to turn it over to the audience. And for those of you who wanted to comment on something each other said, work it into your response to a question. It would be ideal if you could direct your question at one member of the panel so we don't have one question and three responses, which will give us very few questions. There's a hand here, and I think we've got two hands. We have three hands, but somebody's bringing mics. So this is the first one I saw right there, and then I'll go over to you.
My question is...
just introduce yourself.
I am Zahir Abbas, 2013 Next Generation Leader from Pakistan. So it's probably very much linked to my own interest, because I'm working with the men and boys, how to really make them to in favor of women empowerment efforts. So my question is to you, Siham, maybe you can reflect on what's the role of men in having women to make a difference?
Absolutely. Great.
Thank you.
Thank you, Zahir, for this good question. You could give me also the chance to reveal something in my heart, but let's give your answer first. The man could play a very good role in making differences with the woman, because there are two the policies that I believe in. I really wanted to highlight them here with you also. The first one is, we should not only focus on women and to empower the women program, just in aiming to giving the awareness for the women issue for women. But we have to focus on the awareness of men for women issues. This is important. And the second policy that I believe also, let the man to be part of the women issue solution, to be on the table discussion, to be on the panel, to be on the conferences, to take part, because coming to the reality, women have the issue with men. So who will solve it if the man is not working with women together to face this problem and make differences together? That's why I I would say that I'm not agreeing to have four women here today to discuss the women issues while there is no male partner to be with us, at least to hear about their view and approaches to give us. That's why it's important for the man to be partner with us to make changes and face challenges. Thank you.
So to the organizers, if you empower... Yeah, I was going to say, you empower women and they will speak up. There was that one over here.
Aubrey, I'm with the Policy Design Studio here at the McCain Institute. I'm going to direct my question toward Ms. King, but any of you guys can answer. I think an unfortunately common experience for many professional women is when a man in your field explains your field to you. So my question for you is, how do you deal with men in your field discrediting your opinion, and how do you pick your battles? When is it appropriate to call them out, and when do you have to just bite your tongue?
You really want me to answer that? I'd be called that transformational leader, disruptor. Actually, I think there's a name for that. It's called mansplaining. And first of all, I think because I've been doing this a long time, the younger me would have answered differently than this me. Today, I take that in context and compassion. I meet my brother. Mm-hmm. Often, he's enthusiastic. It doesn't always come from a negative intention. It just comes from how he's used to engaging. I think that when we learn to not reduce ourselves or subordinate in that moment, that's not the right response, nor is just picking a fight, but simply standing in your knowledge, coming right back peer to peer, comes back to the first readiness level is, I am a peer. I am worthy to be here. That's more than a mantra. That's really a posture from the inside out. He will recognize that. He will meet you there. So I think to the degree that we continue to practice being with that, neither retreating or reacting, and coming right back to the center of our power, not anger, power, that is the antidote in any scenario with a man or a woman.
I will just add, I think it's a wonderful answer, and if you haven't read Amy Cuddy's Power Poses, you should. How you actually project yourself physically is very important, but you're also giving him a chance to save face. He doesn't necessarily know that you know more or as much as he does, and if you confront, you embarrass him, and he may become more belligerent because he may have been socialized that way, as opposed to letting him sort of back down and say, oh, well, of course. So I often say something like, well, you know, of course you know that I've worked on something, but in a way that provides some face saving. That was a lovely answer. There was a question here.
Thank you. This is Henry Hedger, retired government. A question for Dr. Ringera. You mentioned the fight against AIDS in your country and how serious this is in the world. And of course, in your area, it was quite serious. So I wondered, we now have Zika. We now have to worry about defeating Zika, among many other issues in the world. We wonder, is there anything wrong with the general direction the world is going? There's something called mega projects, alternative to war, where, you know, some very huge infrastructure project can be created that's beneficial to mankind. This is part of the alternatives to war. So I wondered, is there anything that women can do to assist in this type of endeavor?
Can you rephrase the question?
So I think the question was, if you think about using the HIV/AIDS epidemic as a opportunity, you can do that individually, but what about the larger systemic issue of HIV/AIDS, or indeed today Zika? How do you relate what you do at the individual level to that broader systemic level?
Good. Thank you for that question, and probably I don't have an answer to it, but I am going to share with you a little bit about my philosophy in responding to the local versus the global impact of things like disease. And even looking at the phenomena of development and aid, in my work, I have learned that creating contextual responses within the issues that are affecting the women, for example, in my village first and then spreading that to Kenya is very important, because I will tell you, there is a worldview out there that tells us how things are, that we think because it is scientific and it has been researched by someone else, that is the truth. I have learned to question the truth, that is the truth for who? Who defines development for me? Who defines how HIV and AIDS is a whatever we call it to be, vis-a-vis how I experience it every day in my life, with my family, with my community. And so starting from that level, I say on changing, stewarding the issue at the local level. When I go to conferences then where we talk about that level of things, I always go back to what I have seen, changes on the ground, translating into that which can be borrowed, that which can be learned from the local and expand to the global. And I'll tell you this because I struggled for a long time when I was a graduate scholar to understand the context within which HIV and AIDS is happening globally. So you have the pharmaceutical story, you have the economic story, you have the health WHO story, and then you have the story of my Kenyan Ministry of Health, but the story of the person living with this disease was never told. So where is the change needing to take place? Where is the change needing to take place? When I figured that, I didn't quite drop this macro level of things, I decided, let me understand how I can work with a woman to live a quality life with this disease and ensure that her children don't have to go to the street because they are orphans.
Thank you. And I know this is part of the end. It's part of the NGL philosophy that concrete action plans that have to take place on the ground within a larger context, but that is a core part of the leadership. We have time for one more question. I'm going to give it to the person way in the back, since I've been discriminating in favor of the front of the room. So there's a young woman there very in the back. Last question.
Thank you very much. My name is Liliana Gutina. I'm from Embassy of Moldova. Appreciating very much your work and the efforts which you do on these challenging times, I would like to quote Eleanor Roosevelt, who said that a woman is like a bag of tea. You never know how strong is she until she'll get into hot water. So I would like to put a question to our kind moderator, taking in consideration that you was holding a very important position, a first female on State Department, being the policy planner. I would like to ask you, what do you think will drive next women diplomats on making changes on international relations and on new digital diplomacy? Thank you very much.
So one last, you said, who do I think will drive that? So I think one of the great questions for American diplomacy at the moment, there are many, but Secretary Clinton had a much broader view of what diplomacy is, and it was a quite visionary view. And I see Michael Polt there to the left, and he served with me in the State Department, and he knows what I'm talking about. She really thought, of course, there's state-to-state diplomacy. It is critically important. The U.S. and Russia, the U.S. and China, the U.S. and Iran, these are relationships that are vitally important for global peace and security, and they're not going away. But she also saw, and it goes actually, Karambu, to your last point, that we must, in this age, this digital age, where in theory we can communicate with every human being who has a cell phone. We don't need embassies. We can tweet, or we can directly text. So in this age, we need to practice diplomacy to the people as well. So government to government, government to people, and she spent a lot of time on the special representative, the ambassador for women's affairs, the ambassador for youth affairs, ambassador for civil society, ambassador for Muslim majority countries, ambassador for entrepreneurship, actually creating diplomatic posts to engage the people of a country and to facilitate people-to-people contact. And I think it is a critical question as to whether that broader vision continues, because it is so easy to fall back into what I think of as oak-paneled room deal-making, which is important. These deals do need to be made, but if we don't engage people around the world, all people, women and men together, young people as well as older people, people of different religions, people of different professions, we are never going to be able to solve global problems. We cannot address those problems simply nation to nation. They have to be nation to nation, but also nation to population and people together. So with that and the 000 staring at me, we've had an extraordinarily eloquent panel. I've been writing down these lovely phrases of dancing with life, of women, rising of women into the truth of who they are. I can't imagine a better panel to discuss women's empowerment, except perhaps with the addition of some very eloquent men. Next year, thank you very much.